Yo, yo, yo!
What's going on? We're here in the beautiful skyline setting of our new studio setup.
Exactly.
You know, we're going fresh indeed. So hope everybody's feeling good. Hope you're having a great week. Ty's got some great info, as usual, to drop on you. And, you know, lots of events coming up that we're doing, which is cool.
Yeah, we've got a number of events coming up.
I just confirmed the All In Growth Conference with billionaire Naveen Jain, with a guy, Brad Lee from Lightspeed VT,
nice.
Who his virtual training powers Cardone, Cardone College, Cardone University,
yeah.
And a bunch of other people. Michael Burt's going to be there, Coach Michael Burt.
I'm headed to the UK next week.
Yeah, you are.
To London with Robert Kiyosaki, so that's going to be fun.
I like that.
Yeah.
I like that. We're going to send you with a Canon this time, so you can video everything
right?
And bring it back.
I'm not good with cameras.
I know. My dad's the same way. My dad never takes pictures when he speaks.
That's why I've got you and our camera guy.
Our accounting. Well, that's why we have the podcast. If we didn't have the podcast, we'd really be struggling.
Yeah.
So, all right, guys, we're going to kick in the intro, and we'll be on our way.
Cash, cast, coming in fast. Relative info on investments that will smash. Miss out on this, you'll be coming in last. Acoustic Force, bringing the intro blast.
Hey, this is Vanilla Ice, and I'm chilling with my man, Ty Lasseter. And I want to tell you, one command, stop, collaborate, and listen. Key City Capital is about to throw down. So get it how you live it. And always remember, cash, cash, baby. Bet.
I have had a number of sellers that have told us that we got the deal because we touched their property, we touched them, we had marketing to them, we were in front of them more often than our competition was.
Cash, cash, baby.
I like it.
Bet.
He's awesome.
Right.
So he'll be in San Antonio at the Wholesaling Ground Zero event.
Yeah.
February.
I'm working on a couple other events with him. So
awesome.
Hopefully those will be an announcement soon.
Dude, it's awesome because every time I see somebody that's out at an event that he's rapping at or that he's a part of or whatever, he takes a lot of time for people.
Oh, yeah, he does. Yeah, he
makes video shout outs for people.
I went to one,
takes pictures.
I went to one with him in Denver a couple of months ago. And so we went up there, met his team and everything. And I kid you not, the line was probably 600 or 700 people long after the concert.
Around the corner?
No, this is after the concert to go see him and meet him backstage.
Oh, wow.
And that's how many people bought VIP tickets to go have a quick meet and greet with him. And he stayed there until, I think it was 3:30 a.m., and he had a 5 a.m. flight to catch back to Florida.
Wow.
Yeah. Stayed there all night meeting and greeting people. But, yeah, he's a great guy. He knows how to network. I get a lot of my networking coaching and advice from him. I mean, obviously he was a small town Texas kid,
right?
And figured out how to network and how to get in with people. That's what boosted him to put out a single, and then same thing with his TV show and everything.
Right.
So, anyways, you're stuck and you can't find a market. I'm going to help you choose a market this morning. This is what we're going to talk about: how you start choosing a market and some of the parameters that we use to go into those markets. We talked last week about breaking down a market once you've chosen it. So let's help you pick that market. All right.
I'm going to take my coffee and start taking notes. You guys get your notepads out.
Go.
Rock and roll.
All right. So the first thing that we do, one of the very first things that we look for is we have three primary factors in a market that we go into. And the first one is a very strong job market. And so one of our favorites is universities. We love cities that have universities in them. And I'll kind of get into that for a little bit here in just a minute. But on the flip side, you know, job markets, you've got markets. What you don't want to go into is a major factory market where there's one or two factories that run the entire market. Like I was talking with some people yesterday, that they have a large footprint in a market where there is one manufacturer in that market that has a ton of jobs that employs a bunch of people. But if something happens to that one company, then that entire market crumbles, right? And so you want some diversification. So if it's not universities that you're going to focus on, like we're working on a market right now in Florida that there's not a university in the market. There's a couple that are close by, but there is four major market centers and job centers there that run a significant portion of the economy. And on top of that, it's a vacation destination. So not only do you have the jobs that support the existing economy, but you've also got the vacationers as well. And a lot of the baby boomers are relocating to this market. So you've got a lot of retirees moving in. You've got a strong job market and you've got vacation. On the flip side is the universities. One that we like a lot here in Texas is university markets. And so that job market is going to be one of the last, a university is one of the last jobs or entities to shut down in an economy. Like, look back at all the universities that have ever been shut down. There's not many. And that's because universities and school has been built in the U.S. economy to create the highest paying job earners, the highest paying W-2 workers, so that they can drive the economy. The higher you make in a W-2 job, the more taxes you pay, right? So that's something that runs the economy. And the government knows that. So the government funds universities as often and as much as possible because the universities create those W-2 employees, right? And so when you go to university, you know, the people that get the best jobs coming out of universities are doctors, lawyers, accountants, engineers, and other professional jobs like that, right? And so the universities set you up to go get a high paying W-2 job. And so, like myself included, when I got out of college, I went and started working in an accounting firm with a base salary of $60,000 and a sign-on bonus that was a decent sign-on bonus. And this was, you know, 12 years ago. And so that's gone up from there. And so that's kid coming out of college, right? Making with your bonus and everything, almost six figures. And that year, for those few years that I had a W-2 paying job, I paid a more than double in taxes what I pay now, and I make now 10 times more than what I made then, right? And so the government knows that. So they're going to fund those colleges to put out those employees that are going to have the high-paying jobs and pay more in taxes. So when you have that, you've got a very, very stable economy, right? You've got students that are coming in that are creating an influx in the population, so your rental market is really strong. And then if you use some of the cool tricks that we use, we put the parents as guarantors on rental agreements. So, you know, when that college kid, like, I love him, you know, he lives in my property, but when he throws a rager party with all of his frat boys and everything and destroys a wall, like, bro, your parents are on the rental agreement for that as well. And so dad and mom aren't always too happy when that happens. And so we don't have that happen too often, you know, because of those fail safes that we put in place, right? So you've got an influx in population, and so you've got a strong rental market. You've also got the professors, right? So the professors that have jobs. Then you've got everybody that works for the school that has jobs, right? And so that just builds a strong economy, okay? So that's the first thing that we look for is the universities. But with that, where there's a university, you're going to have financial institutions. And so we look for a couple of strong primary banks and financial institutions that we can go to. And first of all, use as local lending and local funds for our real estate portfolio. But not only that, is it helps drive that economy, because where there's a college, you've got financial institutions, because you've got the students who are getting student loans and they're putting cash on deposits, right? They're going to have, maybe if they have a job or if they have the student loan, they get the loan in and they have living expenses and things like that that go into deposits. So that cash that's in deposits, right? So you've got to have the bank for that. Then you've also got the professors and everybody that works for the bank. So they're going to be buying houses. So the banks are going to be lending money to buy houses. And then they're also going to have deposit accounts as well. Okay. So you've got the universities that create this job funnel. Then you got the financial institutions that move in to take advantage of the opportunities that the university brings. And when the government is funding these universities and stuff, you know, the university, the entity itself, has close relationship with the local financial institutions as well, right? So it drives a really, really strong financial market. Then the next thing that we look for is a strong medical presence. And the colleges, especially some of the larger colleges, I've got people already posting and asking questions. I've already got three questions picked out, so that we'll go through those here in a minute. I do have the three questions picked out. I actually had somebody call me yesterday about a couple of questions, so we'll get into that here in a minute. But if you do have questions, keep posting them or keep messaging them to me, and I'll try to answer some of them after the podcast as well. But anyway, so you got the medical centers, right? And these medical centers come in because you've got an influx in the population that's not actually on the population census, because the college, the students aren't included in that. But, you know, in some cities, take Ann Arbor, Michigan, for example, that's a great one, or Tuscaloosa, Alabama. You know, some of these big college towns, the college itself has a larger population than the city sometimes, right? And so you've got to have an infrastructure that can handle that growth, and especially during the year and during the semester. So the medical institutions have to come in to help cover that, right? You're gonna have students that have issues. You've got all the sporting events. So you've got, you know, unfortunately, you've got injuries in all, basketball, in football, in track, in soccer, in volleyball, all of that. In baseball, you're gonna have injuries. So the hospitals have to be there to support that. And then you're gonna have the university putting out doctors, right? And nurses and things like that. So a lot of the times when you have a really strong university and a medical field that comes in, you'll also end up having a nursing school that is a sister school to one of the universities that's in town or something like that. And so they're providing nurses that come out and are looking for jobs. And so that's what those hospitals bring. Okay. And so when you get those hospitals there as well, you're going to have all of the staff that need living. And so I've talked about before, the market that we're in, we're trying to reach 70% of the United States population, right? You want your product to reach multiple people so that you're going one to many, not one to one. One to one, obviously you can have high ticket items one to one, but it takes a lot more work. So if you go one to many, if you, for example, Elon Musk, he has high-end cars with Tesla, right? But when they launch new products, he actually launches that from a stage, one to many, so that he can reach as many people as possible. Same thing with Apple. Steve Jobs will go to a stage and he'll present new products on stage, right? And so that's what you want to do with your product. You want to reach as many people as possible. So we're not reaching the one percenters. We're not going after those multi-million dollar properties. And we're not going into the low income area. We're looking in Texas. Most of the markets in Texas, we're looking in the $700 to $1,100 a month, right? So we want rent or our monthly mortgage payments or owner finance payments to us to be in the $700 to $1,100 range. And here's why. So when you're in these markets, you can reach the college students. You can also reach, in a strong economy, when the economy's strong, you reach the upper end blue collar workers, right? So the people that are working in those factories and in those markets and in those blue collar industries in that market, right? So you've got the upper end ones that can reach that. But then on the flip side, if the market goes down, when you're in that $700 to $1,100 a month, you're going to reach the lower tier, like the new jobs, the new white collar jobs, like me when I came out of college. You right? I had a good paying job, but I couldn't go into a 1% property at that time. But I could get the upper end of that middle income property, right? And so that's what you're reaching. You're reaching 70% of America with that product, and so that's what we focus on. And so now you're going to get the nurses and a lot of the staff that works for the hospital living in your products. And that's who is a lot of our owner finance buyers and our rent-to-own buyers, is the staff and the things like that, that are at the universities, that are at the hospitals and at the banks around as well. And so that drives a strong market when you've got the universities or you've got more than two or three major job producers in a market, right? So that way, if you have one that loses funding or has some sort of financial crisis, you still have two or three more that give a strong infrastructure in that market. So, you know, I want you guys to go check out last week's as well. If you missed last week, so you're getting this, we've chosen a market. Last week, I talk about breaking down that market once you get there and how to do that. So, you know, that wraps up what we're talking about and how I go in and choose a market. So now that I've chosen one, I break it down. So I'm going to bring Pat back up here, let Pat ask a couple of questions. We'll go back and forth and kind of create some Q&A for you guys.
This coffee is really good, by the way.
Yeah, it is.
Phenomenal job out there.
What do you think?
I like it.
You now know how to go choose a market here in Texas.
I like it. Well, and I've noticed there's a consistency here with the college. You guys like to pick that college scene.
There is, yeah.
Because there's housing in that area. Yeah. I know that it's super funny, something you said. I went to Mizzou when I first graduated high school, I went to the state university,
right,
first, and then I eventually moved to Arizona because it was just a little bit more technical for the digital stuff I wanted to learn than Missouri was. But I noticed that, like, all the housing in Columbia is based on the college students,
absolutely,
not based on the people that are actually from Columbia,
absolutely,
Missouri.
And well, and I get questions similar to that a lot too, though. Like, I'll tell people, hey, we, you know, one of our major focuses is college towns, and we like to go into college towns. And they're like, well, I don't like renting to college students. Well, the reason they don't like it, first of all, is a fear. The college student isn't going to take care of their property. Great. So you can fix that. Like, how do we think ahead and how do we fix that problem?
Right.
Who's going to prevent that from happening? Well, 90% of the time in a university situation, if a kid's in school, like, he's got a good foundation back home and somebody that is probably helping him be there.
That was the other half of what I was
going to say.
And if
they're not helping him be there, he's having to work himself. So he's going to take care of your property. So if he's getting help to be there, who's helping him? Well, it's the parents.
Mom and dad.
Mom and dad are helping him. When
so
he screws
that
up
rent,
that house, you're getting that rent. And when he screws up that house, if you put them on the hook for it, he's got more responsibility because he doesn't want to take dad's
That was
food,
the other
right?
half of what I was going to kind of
yeah.
ask. So you're guaranteed to get that payment. Because
not necessarily guaranteed,
well,
but your risk
right.
is much
okay,
more
yeah.
reduced.
Okay.
Yeah,
there's
your risk
always
is
risk.
Much more reduced. Yeah. But then on top of that is, you know, and I'll tell people, well, I don't like to rent to college students. Great. Like 75% of our portfolio in those university towns aren't actually targeted towards the students. It's just that the university creates an infrastructure and a network in a city that makes a city a very good place to go invest in.
Yeah.
Right. And so now you're not going into like a Detroit that had, now it did have more than one manufacturer there, but all those manufacturers, it was tires and cars, right? So when that industry failed, everything went away.
Right.
So what you want to do is you want to go into a city. If you're looking at a city because of some manufacturers or because of some jobs, you want to make sure that those jobs and those companies are diversified. They're not all in one industry. So you wouldn't want to go into a market where you've got like Campbell's Soup and Frito-Lay's, and all of a sudden, you know, they find out that a product that they put in processed food is going to be no longer legal by the FDA.
Right.
Right. Because now all of a sudden both of those companies are gone,
yep,
shut down, or they have to come out with a new product. Right. And so same thing with Detroit. It was, everything was car related. So what you want to look at is a market that maybe they've got some entertainment, right? They've got a huge vacation place like Orlando, right? Orlando has entertainment there.
Huge.
But then they've got golf. They've got a really strong golf presence there. They did until now. Now the PGA of America is relocating to Plano here in DFW, but PGA of America was in Orlando.
Right.
And so you had four
Disney
or five
World,
major,
right?
right, entertainment. You had some major employers there that were all diversified. And so then also with that entertainment, it brings in the vacation and stuff like that. So those are some of the things that you want to look for. If there's
yeah.
not going to be a major university that you're going to look at, you want to look for some diversification in the job markets. And then with that, when you've got a lot of jobs and strong jobs like that in blue collar areas, you're obviously going to have the banks and the medical there as well.
Right.
Right. It's going to create a strong economy. And there's tons of markets like that in Texas. And everybody's always asking, oh, where are you at? Well, I'm actually in five markets in Texas.
Right.
Because there's so many of them. And there's more than that. Like, we're looking at more of them right now.
It's so spread out.
Yeah, it is. And so you don't just have to look at the Dallas.
The more
and Houston,
I drive around, I'm like, wow.
Right. And obviously you've got San Antonio and Austin, but right now Austin's got water on one side and it's got some undevelopable areas because of the land and the layout of the land there. And so it's kind of becoming unlike the Dallas-Fort Worth area that's a 360 degree growth area. You've got Austin that's more like a San Francisco or something. And so it can't grow as wide. And it's heavily built around, I mean, it is the capital of Texas, but it's also built around computer and computer science and things like that.
Tech.
So technology. And so it's an industry specific area. And so right now with everybody moving to, you know, you've got a bunch of tech companies moving to Texas because it's easier to open up a business in Texas than it is in California. So they're moving to Texas, they're moving to the East Coast and a couple of places in North Carolina and things like that because the cost of living is lower.
Yep.
Well, what does that do? That brings all those jobs here and they're industry specific. So the market goes up really, really high. And so it's falsely inflated, because when something happens to that market, that's going to be one of the first real estate markets to crash. And so we're not heavy in Austin because of that. Yeah. Now, there's other players that are, and you want to do short-term
things. I think I just saw
there.
Something about an Uber headquarters coming to Texas as well. I think Kelly Smith shared that.
Yeah.
She shares some good stuff. Yeah. By the way, you should follow Kelly, because she shares great stuff.
She does. And so you want to look at those diversification factors when you go into a city. And yeah, I like the universities, but it's not just because I'm renting to the college.
Yeah, students. I get that.
It's because of the infrastructure that
that's why I asked, because there's always a method to your madness. It's never really targeted around one thing.
Yeah.
There's other little dots that are bringing value to those investments.
Absolutely. I'm always thinking 8 and 10 steps
right
ahead. We had a bunch of meetings yesterday with some of our council and stuff like that, and it was brought up, and it, like, you know, a couple of people, there was a couple of questions that were asked, and the way I answered, like, everybody, some of the people in the room understood and some of them didn't. They were like, I don't understand. And one of our council members was like, well, this is what he's thinking. He's actually thinking of what's going to be the ramification. If you do this and then this happens and then this happens, what's going to happen now?
Right.
And that's where I'm thinking. It's always like, you know, it's okay. For example, Donald Trump tweets obnoxious things.
Oh yeah.
And sometimes you're just like, dude, if you would just shut up, like, you wouldn't have so much
kickback.
Yeah, you wouldn't have so much hate against you, right? But when he makes a post on Twitter, he already has 5 or 6 more responses built out to that.
Yeah, he's
and people don't understand it, right?
There is a method.
And
he knows
when I make this post, this is what the response is going to be. He knows that the people that support him aren't going to be the ones that respond. It's going to be the unsupporting members that respond. And he knows what they're going to say.
He knows
there's going to be 2 or 3 options, and this is what those are going to be. And they're going to say it. So he immediately has a response to that. And then he has another response and another response. And you've got to be able to think ahead like that in business in order to have a business that's sustainable and will grow. Otherwise, you're going to be reactive.
And we talked about that with Myron for the content. You travel a lot. You're not a social media, you know. I'm a little bit of a social media. I'll just say it. And I'm out there, boom, 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 everywhere.
I mean, I have one of my people do my social media.
Yeah, so what we do,
part of
the reason why this podcast is going to become more and more and more valuable is it's an opportunity for us to not only ask questions from the community, but to also bring up educational things. That's why we're starting to split it up a little bit.
Yeah,
and then we can kind of chop that up. And
we're going to
start to send some of these small parts out as we move forward.
I've had so many people start calling me and sending me, I've started getting people that don't know my number. I started getting Facebook calls.
Oh, that's
calling
awesome.
Me from Facebook and asking
questions.
Yeah,
I get that sometimes
like
too.
That. It's like, you know, a lot of times I just have to respond with, like, you know, send me a Facebook message.
But
I think
it's good that now you're making yourself available online, where 6 months ago we just had published your page.
Exactly.
So this is all a new endeavor for you.
Right.
And, you know, I was talking to Boone about this, too. He was X amount of years ago or whatever on his Instagram knocking walls down. And he's like, well, I mean, like we've talked about on here, he had to make the transition to clone himself in that department.
Absolutely.
So that he could move up. And now he's got his own office. He's got his own all this different stuff. He's got people doing this and that and the other thing.
Right.
He's got to delegate those tasks now.
Exactly.
Or there's no way that, or he's always going to be stuck knocking down walls.
Yeah, I mean, if you're always the one that does all the work, like, you can only do so much.
And TJ was talking about that on a post to his the other day, too.
Yeah, he and I, so TJ was in my office the other day. Phenomenal conversation. We met for, like, almost 2 hours, I think. Like, a phenomenal guy. The guy, he does real estate way different than I do.
Right.
But there's so many different avenues of real estate that you can get into. And so we were talking about it and stuff, and a lot of what he does is more short term. He does a lot of flips and stuff like that. But when we were talking about it, like, he understood, like, a lot of the things he was saying, I could tell that he's thinking well ahead
in
his business. But he's starting to leverage himself. If you don't ever leverage, and it's the same thing in buying properties. When I got started, I didn't use leverage as far as money. Like, we were using, you know, I got started and I was able to do one property. I put down the down payment that I had saved up. And a partner had saved up, and we got a loan. And then from there, we started building, and we would get less and less loans. And so we were doing as much of it with our own money as possible. Well, you can only do that so many times. Like, we got to where, you know, we had done a bunch of deals, but we were still only able to do 5, maybe 6 at a time because we're using all our own money. It doesn't matter if you have $100,000, If you have $10,000, $100,000,
how much money do you really need?
Well, look at George Ross, one of my coaches. So George Ross had a $400 million company at one point. But even if you had $400 million, like, okay, you're gonna move up your asset class, you're gonna buy in a different asset class. He's buying sky rises in New York, right? He had his own radio station, and so he owned, the money was not made in his radio stations. It was made in advertisements, obviously, right. But those ran the overhead. His money was made in the property that he bought to run his radio stations in. And so he would buy property in. He would put the radio station on one floor, and then he would lease out everything else, right? And so that's what his assets were.
I was talking with Craig about how kind of McDonald's is kind of like a real estate company. And then Kmart set it on an interview too.
Yeah, Kmart got shut down. Or Kmart did shut down, but they were able to get by because of their real estate value.
Interesting.
They had very high value real estate.
They were everywhere.
Yeah, exactly. And so, but if you don't leverage, just like with leverage with money, once I started realizing, hey, if I'll go out and use other people's money and we'll partner, so they get 50% and I get 50%, but now all of a sudden I can diversify. So instead of doing five at a time, I can go out and I can do 15 or 20 at a time.
Right.
Right. Because I'll come in and I won't put up 50% of the cash. I'll put up 25% of the cash needed to close, and then my investor will put up 75%, and then I'll go get the private capital loan.
Right.
And so then I'm able to spread my money and my availability out further. And I can do a lot more deals. So now I'm more diversified. Now if, you know, on your rental portfolio and on your construction portfolio, you know, if you've got more properties, your vacancy factor is not going to affect you as much. So
right.
I was looking at some, I mean, I look at my competition and what they're doing and stuff, and I've noticed that there's a lot of people out there with a ton of vacancies right now. We're operating with our properties that are completed with construction and livable, ready to live in. We're at a 96% occupancy.
Boone and I talked about that.
It's like 96.6.
Which is
high. So
it
is. So we're just over a 3% vacancy factor. And as soon as our properties are ready for the market, We're getting them occupied quickly because of our pipeline of buyers and renters. And there's not many people that are doing that. But what that allows is that allows you to continue to grow and diversify. If you've got only a few properties and there's a bunch of vacancies, you're at a massive risk.
Right.
Right. So that's what leverage.
Yeah,
and then in the people side of leverage, once I started leveraging and I started
there's
handing
so
off,
much to this.
Yeah, I started handing
people
my
see this
social
on the
media.
Internet and they think it's so easy.
Oh, they either think it's easier
or
they think it's a joke. Oh, like so many people, like I hear so many people. No, you've got it. You need to be going to all the auctions, or you need to be going to look at all your properties, or you need to be going to do all this.
Right.
And you need to be doing the work. If you're doing the work, you're saving money. No, you're not. You're saying that your value is worth whatever the work is.
And that was
why
I brought
up
TJ's post this morning about, listen, I got to pay people to do certain stuff.
Yeah,
you know?
Because they're better at doing that. They're faster. So if I'm sitting here tiling the wall, I'm valuing myself at whatever I would pay the person to tile the wall. But not only that is, if I'm getting a professional to tile the wall, they can do it faster, more efficient, and better than
then
I can.
You can anyway.
And so I can actually pay them a little bit more.
Right.
Because now I can do more of them because they know how to manage a team. And so they can do five tile jobs at a time, so I can do five properties instead of one where I'm working on.
Well, and I love that. And I always tie it into what I do because now we've got Paul who's helping us set stuff up. And so I show up this morning and it's not just me. So we can add
multiple
things.
I'm on the road
now.
No matter what I'm doing. He sends me a message on Monday that has content for all week on all my social media platforms. So now instead of me, and it's based off of videos and stuff that I've sent him. So I've written him copy. I've done videos. Now I have him go through it and pick out the things that he's going to put in the social media content. And he does all the pictures. He does everything. So now I can go and in one day of the week, I can provide the content, get pictures done, and start reviewing the content. I hand it off to him. And now I don't have to do the daily task of going in and posting all my social media stuff.
And I think that's important because that's part of what I want to do moving forward is like we talk about cloning ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
I see Brad Lee say that a lot. And
right.
I think it's so cool that, you know, I'm able to associate with some of these people because there are levels to this game.
It's tough to do. So many people.
It is.
I found out the people that aren't able to do that is people that think that they have to be the smartest person in the room and think that they're better than everybody. When you realize, when I stepped back and I started thinking like Mark Zuckerberg or, you know, like like Google and all these large companies, they, and I've said this before, they hire people and they bring people in that can think on their own, that are smart, well-educated, but they just aren't ready. They're not willing to take the risk of being an entrepreneur.
Right.
I'm willing to take that risk. So then I'll bring smart people in that don't want to take that risk, and I'll empower them to help me leverage.
Right.
Right. And, but if I want to, if I have to be the smartest person in the room and I know how to do everything because I'm the best at whatever it is that I'm doing, I'm never going to find somebody that can clone me. I don't want to clone me. I don't want a specific image of me. I want somebody that can do the tasks that I need done. Then I can do that final 20% to make it my piece, to make it me.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that's why I think it's so cool that we've got a little bit of help that just started off with us and the webcam. We have a little DSLR.
Oh, man, we're moving
and
quick.
And now we're going to get to a point where we're going to have a full studio that people can come into and record advertisements and voiceovers and custom songs.
Exactly.
Hire people to speak at their event or perform at their event. And we've got a full shop of talent and service that we can provide. And that's where all of this is going. And it's like you said, that's why it was more affordable for me to come here to Texas to do this, what I love doing, and build it out with people that understand business structure better than I am.
Exactly.
I can't sit around and think I'm the best at all these different things when I need to be focused on what I'm good at.
Exactly.
And that's getting out there and meeting people and having a good time and using my passion to create value for people.
Exactly.
So
yeah,
I think
it's like me. I mean, I know I am not good at implementation or putting together and following through with the process that it takes to get to the vision that I have. But what I know I am good at and what my team knows
setting
that I'm good at is that vision. Like, this is what we want. This, so we've got a new business idea. We're going into a new market or whatever the case may be. I'm the one that has that is most equipped with setting that vision. Here's the market that we want to be in. Here's the new business idea. This is what we want it to look like. This is what we want to do. Here's 10% of how you're going to get there. I need you to build the map out to get there, right? And then we've got a team that is perfect at implementing that map.
Right.
And so the executive team, we all get together and we say, okay, this is how it needs to be done. Now operations, you go build it.
Yeah.
Right. Marketing, you go get it done and you go sell it.
Right.
Right. And so we've got a team around that so that I don't have to do everything because I can't do everything. If I did, we're never going to grow. We're going to just continue buying a couple of properties.
And it spills over too. And that was what I was saying. It spilled over into the way I'm doing my business now.
Yeah.
So I'm able to kind of look at how that's working over here and, okay, well, how can I start implementing those steps so that I can fast track what I'm trying to do, where I'm trying to get. And it's pretty incredible.
All right, let's move on. We got Q&A. I want to get through these. So I've got three good questions. One of them, and I actually get this a lot, and we made this mistake early on when we started really
growing.
You mean
you made mistakes?
Absolutely. Make mistakes, and I just don't repeat them. And then I try to learn as many mistakes as I can from somebody else so that I don't even encounter that mistake.
Right.
But one of the mistakes that we made early on when we started building out portfolios in a couple of other cities was we took properties that we would buy a portfolio of properties in a probate or something like that, or we would get a number of properties together and they would have some tenants in them. Knowing that there was a lot of deferred maintenance on the property and they needed to rehab to bring it to full market value, but we got it and we got lazy. And we're like, well, it's rentable, it's livable, we can owner finance it as is, let's do that. And so we would put somebody in the property. But the problem with that is first of all, the property's gonna depreciate faster. Like, you're gonna have more problems quicker.
Got it.
And so the question is, I've got a livable property, should I go ahead and start the refi process? And what that is, that's a fear of people. They see it and they're not wanting to either let the tenant that's in there, let that contract lapse so that they can do the rehab, or they're not wanting to evict them for if there's a reason that they can't evict them. They're wanting to get comfortable. They have a fear and a comfort level of, well, I've got somebody in there, I can at least collect some money.
Right.
Right. And so what you have to do is you have to trust your process. And the process to get your portfolio to the best value is to buy it. And if there's a contract in place, a tenant in place that is a good tenant and they're just paying under market, well, you have to let them fees out that contract, right?
And then raise the value of
and
the
so then
property,
at that
correct?
Point, so yeah, exactly. So let's say that there's 3 months left on it. Okay. So, and they're paying, they're doing everything you can to evict them. Let them stay in there or come in and offer them a move out option or offer them to live in one of your other properties while you rehab it, or they can move into a hotel for a little while. But you want to go in immediately and bring the property to full market value.
Got it.
No matter what. Because once you get to the point to do your refi, if you haven't done that, you're going to have a bank that comes in. So let's say that you've bought a property that you know it will ARV after it's repaired at $100,000. But if as it is, it's probably worth 80, 85, and you bought it at 65. So you bought it at a discount, great. But it's going to take you about $20,000. So you're going to be all in. So if we bought it at 65, it's going to take about $25,000 or $20,000 to get it to full market value. So it's going to get, you're going to be all in at 85, and now it's worth 100. But if you bought it at 65 and it's currently worth 80 or 85 as it is, and you start the refi process, it's never going to reach its max potential.
Yeah, I get it.
So you're never going to get the full amount of rent.
And sometimes when you spend the money in between, there's not really much left that you're pulling out.
Exactly.
I've noticed that. That's kind of a tough thing.
The mistake that we made is that we had properties that would be worth 100 if we fixed them up, and we paid 50 for them, and they only needed like 10,000 to get to the $100,000 market value.
That's not bad.
10 to 15,000. But as they were, and these were easy, it was exterior stuff and some of the interior stuff. It wasn't just paint and flooring. It was stuff that really needed to be fixed, like cabinets that weren't functioning properly, right? So we could go in and do easy cosmetic repairs. But as it was, in the markets that they were in, they were only going to value at about $65,000 as is.
Right.
And so we made the mistake of leaving tenants in there and turning around and owner financing them or rent to own. And then we started our refi process, and the banks weren't valuing them at what we needed to get all of our money back out. And so we did 10 properties like this very early on. We did a refi of 10 properties, and we found out you cannot do that. What you have to do is you got to go in, you got to do whatever it takes to get the property to full market value, get top market rent for it.
That's what I was going to say. That's probably part of the reason why you've got these renters. If you're not spending the money to fix it up, well, then you can't rent it at the price that's going to make it worth what you're trying to exit at.
You've got to go in and do the value.
I mean, I'm no expert, but I can add.
Don't refi just to leave somebody in place. Like, you're better off. Like, we've got an apartment right now that we fully vacated it and did a full rehab on all of it because of that reason. We knew that, like, I would rather eat the cost right now and have the vacancy on that while we do construction and be paying interest on it with no income coming in to make sure that when we get done, we get the highest value property.
And I'm going to say, as a consumer,
yeah,
I would rather pay $1,600 a month for the nice place
than
$1,900 or $1,100 for something else.
Yeah.
I'll just pay the extra $500 for the extra space, for the extra bedroom to record in.
And a clean place.
Because I'm going to get that back.
Right.
Through the value that I can bring to the marketplace.
Exactly. And this was our second apartment we did that way. The first one we did, we vacated it, and then we rented it back up. And so then we increased rents by 50% by doing that.
Yeah.
And then you don't have this false expectation of people that are living in there that are paying $600 and you go up to $900 and they freak out because they don't see the process that they're living in it as you're doing it. And you know, you're working on a couple of units and then you tell them to move over. We actually had a couple of tenants that we did that. We had two tenants that we left in. One, we moved them over to a unit that we had remodeled already and put them in there. Raised the rent, they were fine with it. But everybody else, it's few and far between that you can do that. So you want to do the value add first. So next one, I actually got a call on this. This was a call that I got. And so person had a list of 100 leads. And they were going to start calling those leads. They skip traced it and we're going to start calling those leads. And they were wondering why they weren't really getting any results from this list. And so, you know, and they were going to do 20 calls a day. And they called and they said, I'd done 20 on Monday. I did 20 on Tuesday. This was last week. And why am I not getting any results from it? And so what I said is, like, I've got more than a single 100 long list of leads, right?
Right.
We pull a list of leads and so we'll have a list of 500 leads. And then once you skip trace it, you've got 800 phone numbers to call. And you've got to dial through. We're calling 300 to 500 numbers a day.
Oh, yeah. I follow Quentin on Instagram. Yeah, and when he scrolls, he's scrolling fast.
Like I've got,
it's like,
yeah,
page
we've got
after
a dollar
page
team.
After page
we've
after
got
page
a dollar
page.
Team, and that's all they're doing.
It's
is
incredible.
They're just dialing constantly with multiple calls going out at a time. And so when he said that, like, he was doing 20 a day, I was like, dude, you've got to, your goal should be, you need to talk to 20 people a day, right? Not make 20 calls. Because if you're making 20 calls, you're probably only talking to one, maybe one person, two people. And he actually said on one of the days, he didn't talk to anybody. Like, he just made the calls and left voicemails. I said, well, dude, first of all, you don't need to be physically leaving voicemails. Do ringless voicemails. Do ringless voicemails.
I get them from Uncle G.
Yeah, I know. Ringless voicemails. And then you're calling, and if you don't get an answer, you're hanging up if you don't have a dialer system like we do. And if you're, you know, if you don't, so if you don't have it, you're calling, you got to call, and then you get to talk to somebody. And so what I told him is, you want to shoot to talk to 20 people a day. And in those 20 people, you want to have at least 5 of the conversations last for 30 minutes. And I have a process behind that. We can talk about that in another episode on how to get a,
you gotta build those relationships, how to get a 30
minute. Yeah, man. You got to build rapport. How to get a 30 minute phone conversation, and how to take that phone conversation and have a close, or at least you've got somebody that's committed to selling you their house on the phone in a 30 minute conversation. So I've got a process behind that. We can go into that.
I like that.
So it's the Ford. It's kind of based on the Ford method. So anyways, yeah, you've got to increase your volume. This is a volume game. And then had somebody that says, I was told that I need $100,000 in an account, in order before I get into the rental game or get into rentals. No, that's not the case. What you need is, you need to buy value. You need to be buying assets that are going to appreciate. So I didn't have $100,000 in an account when I started buying properties.
And well, we kind of talked about that last week with the $5,000 that you can buy a property with and get returns on.
Exactly. Yeah. You don't need that. You definitely need to have a little bit of a reserve to cover. Like, you either need to be able to cover your monthly payment if you have a vacancy, or you need to have a reserve to be able to do that and make sure that you get the project to the refi point. But this goes back to the very first question, and having the livable property and doing a refi just because it's livable.
Right.
No, you need to have a plan to take this property from where it is now to its full market potential. And if that, you know, if that's going to cost you $75,000, then you probably need to have $10,000 to $15,000 in your account. You can go out and you can get a hard money lender or a private lender to do the rest.
Right.
And then you need to expect that to take about 7 months. That's the industry average, is it takes 7 months for one property. Now, a lot of ours we're doing in less than that, but it really depends on the size of the rehab that you're doing. Okay. And so then once you do that, you need to make sure that when you buy this property, you're buying it at a discount. And if you're going to be all in at $75,000, it better be worth a minimum of $100,000 in order to get your money back out.
Got it.
And so you need to know that. You need to know your numbers. And so that goes back into how we break down a market.
Yeah, I'm getting real good at my mental calculator.
We go in and we break down a market. And so I know that if I'm buying a property in this neighborhood, this is the maximum value that I'm going to get out of it.
Right.
And so I this is the low end value that I'm going to get out of it once it's repaired, and I've got a range. So I need to know that no matter what, whatever money I put into it, including the hard money or private lender and my money, that once I'm done with this project, I'm going to get all that out, unless I'm okay with leaving my money in the property.
Right.
And I'm at that point now, like, we'll leave money in properties. We're fine with that. But when you're starting out and you don't have very much money, you better know the numbers up front and know that you're buying a property that's going to appreciate in value over time. But you don't want to expect that appreciation in order to get out your money. You want to know that once you put the value add in it, you're going to be able to get all your money back out. And so that's the problem that I see with so many people right now, is they're going out and they're buying these properties from, I'm not going to name names, but from big wholesalers that are like nationwide and things like that.
Right.
That they don't know what a rehab is or how to do a rehab. They don't know how to properly value a property based on the rehab and things like that. They're just looking at, well, this one should comp out at this, and they don't know the matrix of a neighborhood. They don't know that this 2,000 square foot house is 600 square feet bigger than any other house in the neighborhood, and so they're basing it on square feet and price per square feet as opposed to a range, right? And so now they're falsely inflating that property, and then they're selling it to a newbie investor that doesn't know what they're doing, and that investor has a false expectation in their mind.
Got it.
And so that's when, yeah, you need $100,000 in your bank account to do something like that, because you're going to end up upside down in the property. But if you go in and you know your metrics up front, and you know that the property is going to be worth X when you get done, and it's going to take this amount to repair it, and you're going to buy it at this amount, and a lender will give you 75% of X, as long as you're underneath what the lender is going to give you, then there's no problem with having $15,000 in your bank account.
Yeah,
that's what we do. That's what we have tons of clients that are partners with us on deals that do that. So no, there's no reason to have a huge bank account. You just need to know what you're doing on the front end. And if you don't know what you're doing, then you're going to end up buying properties that have there's no asset value to them. Like, that's why I don't do a whole lot of, and I don't advise doing many mobile homes. Is once you get into mobile homes, like we've got mobile home park, but once you get into that, you're buying, it's like a car. That thing is depreciating faster than anything.
Right.
And so even over time, there's no appreciation there because all you're getting is the value of the land. I give zero value to a used mobile home when I'm buying it. The only thing that I buy a mobile home off of is the value of the land.
Right.
Because I fully like expect that there's a very good opportunity that I'm blowing that mobile home up, or I'm getting it off the land.
Right.
We're gonna have to do something else with it. I mean, it's a mobile home. That's what happens. And so we've got a partner in Indiana that we do a bunch of stuff with. He's actually got a mobile home. He's partnered with a mobile home manufacturer, and so we can get cost mobile homes on new and stuff. And so, you know, that's what you can't go in and expect to buy a mobile home park that's got a bunch of mobile homes on it and rent them out and expect to have any value there. When you're renting a mobile home out, they're going to get destroyed. They're going to lose their value. You can't fix them back up. And a bank is not going to give you a value for that on a refi. And so, yeah, in that case, you need to have cash on hand in order to keep liquid. But other than that, if you're buying an asset and a house that's going to appreciate in value, then you're fine.
Game on. Hey, guys, any questions, hit it up in the comments section. Let us know. And we'll see you guys next time. Keep rocking.